height above the ground. In that case, we're dealing with a unidirectional wind profile, which is going to be associated with a straight hodograph. Now, we can have a straight hodograph come about without necessarily a unidirectional wind profile. We can have the direction of the wind change with height, but still have a straight hodograph. And let me show you an example of this over here. So here we're going to deal with our hodograph over here. We can plot this on a polar coordinate system that can be related to a Cartesian coordinate system as we relate r and theta to x and y. We're not going to deal with the details of that in this particular class, but let's assume that we have a straight hodograph not associated with a unidirectional wind profile, but rather, in this case, just a straight hodograph, where we have southerly flow that becomes more southwesterly with height above the ground over here. So again, it's not unidirectional flow, but it's still a straight hodograph. And that's what we're going to talk about over here. We're going to assume in the background environment that our initial updraft is going to be following a storm motion that represents a mean of the flow within the convective cloud layer, and therefore will be along the hodograph. Because over here, the meridional component of motion in the background environment is going to be constant at every height in the atmosphere, and so the only thing that's changing is our zonal component of motion, and therefore the storm motion will lie along the hodograph, since the value of the meridional component of motion is constant everywhere. The only thing changing is the zonal component of motion. And so our storm motion initially, for initial updraft, before all the perturbation pressures come about, is going to be lying on the hodographs, on the straight hodograph, which I'll mark as C. That refers to the initial updraft's motion over here. And so, also from examination number two, you're going to be showing that the following holds. The horizontal vorticity, which can be associated with any given hodograph, can be expressed as follows. K hat, so the vertical unit vector, crossed with partial UH, partial Z. Well, partial UH, partial Z, over here we're just talking about the vertical shear over here of the horizontal wind. And so let's think about what partial UH, partial Z is from a finite differencing perspective. So we're dealing with UH at the top of some incremental layer, minus UH at the bottom of some incremental layer divided by delta Z from a finite differencing perspective. All right, so we're looking at vertical shear of the horizontal wind, K cross that, and this term, the vertical shear of the horizontal wind, we can think of these as increments of change in horizontal velocity as we go upward through the hodograph. Well, let's consider that. Let's consider the base of some layer over here, some point on the hodograph, which I'll mark with X over here, and that's going to be considered as the bottom of some arbitrarily chosen layer of the hodograph over here. And the top of the layer, let's just arbitrarily choose that to be over here. Now, remember from a homework problem that you guys had to encounter in homework two, we can think of the difference between the top velocity and the bottom velocity as this vector difference as just extending from the bottom to the top. So in this case, the vertical shear vector in a bulk sense is going to extend from the bottom to the top. So this term over here, the vertical shear of the horizontal wind, if we're looking at finite differencing, are just going to refer to incremental chords, C-H-O-R-D-S, or infinitesimal segments, parallel chords, to the hodograph. So effectively, our hodograph sketches out increments of the vertical shear of the horizontal wind as we go up through the profile. So when we take K cross that, our index finger will stick out of the board over here, and then partial U, H, partial Z, that's just going to go down shear, which is like that, since we've already established that we're going to be dealing with these increments that are parallel to the hodograph for the vertical shear of the horizontal wind, which results in a horizontal vorticity that is orthogonal to the hodograph, like this. And that makes complete sense with the right-hand rule. We're just curling our fingers down the deep shear vector, and that is going to be associated with a horizontal vorticity orthogonal to the hodograph at every single point, since we can look at these individual chords and take K cross that, these individual chords compose the hodograph such that our horizontal vorticity is going to be pointing perpendicular to the hodograph and to the left in this case, as we look down the deep shear vector, as we look down the shear vectors along the hodograph. And so in this particular case, let's look at the storm relative flow at any given point along the hodograph. Remember, the storm relative flow VSR is going to be equal to the background velocity at any given point along the hodograph, subtracting out the storm motion. That's why it's storm relative to the storm V minus C. And so it's always going to point from the storm motion vector to the velocity where we're analyzing the inflow or the storm relative flow. So let's consider a point over here. If we want to get the vector corresponding to the inflow at that particular point marked with an X, we'll go from the storm motion vector over here, C, to the point where we're analyzing the flow, which will look something like this. And that is going to be our storm relative vector over here, which is going to be entirely perpendicular to our horizontal vorticity vector. So in this case, and you can see that if we carry that analysis with every single point in the hodograph, at every single point in the hodograph, since our initial storm motion is on the hodograph, our horizontal vorticity will always be orthogonal to the storm relative inflow at every point along the hodograph. And we call that crosswise vorticity, where our vorticity vector is completely perpendicular to our horizontal storm relative inflow. So we see that in the case of the straight hodograph, we get this crosswise vorticity phenomenon take place. Now, let's consider, in this particular case, our background analysis of our storm relative to our storm. So we're going to consider all of those tilting arguments that we talked about earlier relative to that initial updraft over here. So we'll have this analysis, again, relative to our storm motion. We'll have this, let me draw a coordinate system here, X, Z, Y. We'll have our initial horizontal vortex tubes that are going to be angled into the board like this. Along comes our updraft, and that will tilt the horizontal vorticity into the vertical, something like this. And initially, our initial updraft that is being superimposed on the horizontal vorticity will be resulting in this. But all of our storm relative inflow in this particular case is going to be oriented orthogonal to the background environmental horizontal vorticity, like this. So this is the background storm relative inflow that is all perpendicular to our vortex tubes. So the horizontal storm relative inflow that's effectively serving as the ingested matter into our developing updraft will not be residing along our vortex tubes. You can think of those vortex tubes as slinkies, effectively. Imagine these little slinkies that are pointing into the page. All of our inflow is going to be crossing that 90-degree angles. We'll not be residing along it. So all of our inflow, in this case of crosswise vorticity, is going to not be assuming helical paths in the horizontal prior to being ingested into our developing updraft. So since our background flow is crossing our slinkies, it's not able to develop the helical nature, that helical flow that could otherwise be immediately ingested into that initial updraft in support of a rotating updraft right off the start, in this particular case of crosswise vorticity. But the idea here is that, imagine suddenly, in this particular case, that we were to cause an arc to occur on this hodograph. So imagine over here that instead of a completely straight hodograph, we have a small arc over here. Well, let's take this initial storm motion over here. The storm motion will potentially vary as we change the environmental wind profile to be something else, but we'll just assume it's near here or somewhere near here. All of a sudden, we now have over here, for instance, going from C, I'm going to draw a chord over here, to that point. Now our horizontal vorticity is going to be pointing like this, and our storm relative inflow is now going to have a substantial component along the horizontal vorticity vector. And so, because of this arc over here, our background storm relative inflow, which is serving as inflow to the storm, can now follow these background vorticity vortex tubes that can be ingested into that updraft as our rotating updraft, or to effectively serve as the basis for a rotating updraft, since the inflow can follow these background vortex tubes because we have a component of the storm relative inflow along our horizontal vorticity vectors. That background inflow will now reside along these slinkies, these vortex tubes, developing vorticity, developing spin along the horizontal axis that can be then transported into the developing updraft. Now that's contrasted against this particular case over here, where we're dealing with strictly crosswise vorticity, where initially we don't get any coincidence of our initial updraft with vertical vorticity at all in this particular case, since all of the inflow is perpendicular to the background horizontal vorticity. Now all of a sudden, if we have this curvature in the hodograph associated with a component of the low-level inflow parallel to the horizontal vorticity, we can actually be developing these helical trajectories in the low levels that can be ingested into our updraft to immediately support the development of a rotating updraft. So effectively, using this case of crosswise vorticity over here, just kind of summarize what's going on over here. The initial updraft is inefficient at developing rotation via ingesting vertical vorticity. In other words, we don't get vertical vorticity until that updraft has formed in the first place, since all of the inflow has been crossing our horizontal vorticity vectors at 90 degree angles. Our background low-level inflow has not developed any helical paths. But when we have this curvature in the hodograph over here, and we have some of the low-level inflow that's residing along our vorticity vectors in the horizontal, it's effectively lying along these slinkies following more helical motion. In the case of streamwise vorticity, where low-level inflow has a component parallel to the horizontal vorticity, our initial updraft is much more efficient at developing rotation via ingesting vertical vorticity initially from horizontal inflow parallel to horizontal vorticity. So that initial ingestion over here of the inflow that is following these helical trajectories is going to immediately support a rotating updraft when we have some component of the low-level inflow parallel to the horizontal vorticity that we don't have in the case of crosswise vorticity. And so as a result, using this idea of this efficiency for the initial updraft to develop rotation as we have the ingestion of horizontal inflow that is occurring coincident with the horizontal vorticity, we can use a measure of what's called storm relative helicity to describe exactly, or to quantify exactly what we're talking about here. Storm relative helicity is going to be the vertical integral within a layer of air of V minus C. That's just going to be the storm relative flow that we've been talking about, dotted with K, cross partial V partial Z dz over here. And remember, this over here is just the horizontal vorticity. This is just the storm relative flow. So if these are completely orthogonal to each other, then the dot product between them is going to be zero. There will be no storm relative helicity. We don't get this initial updraft developing any rotation at first at all. We have to first tilt the horizontal vorticity into the vertical for that to work out, and we are dealing with strictly crosswise vorticity. But if we do have a component of the horizontal vorticity along the horizontal storm relative inflow, then this value will be non-zero. Our storm relative helicity will be non-zero. And let's take a look at what this looks like on a hodograph. We'll have our straight line hodograph, and then we'll have some arc over here that is not associated with a straight line hodograph. No matter where our storm motion is, whether it's here, whether it's here, whatever it is, we're going to have some area swept out by the hodograph. When you look at a layer of the atmosphere in the low levels, bounded by the bottom of the layer and the top of the layer, associated storm relative inflow vectors over here. That area is called the storm relative helicity. And that is going to be a measure of our propensity for our horizontal inflow to assume helical trajectories that go initially into supporting a rotating updraft via the updraft's ingestion of vertical vorticity immediately from background horizontal inflow that was following helical trajectories and being advected effectively up into the initial updraft without having that tilting process have to take place first in the case of crosswise vorticity. And that storm relative helicity is going to measure at the degree of streamwise vorticity that in this case would be associated with curvature in the hodograph. And let's talk a little bit more about streamwise vorticity.